good evening, everybody, and the warmest of welcomes to this, the first ever live evening event at an Australian Labor Party special platform conference. It's already been a memorable day, and there's still plenty in store to enrich it. My name's Sam Lane. I'm an author and broadcaster who is also sincerely happy to be here with you for tonight's happenings as your host. So what's in store? We have an hour of guest speakers, videos, plus some music and entertainment that will take us around Australia, albeit virtually. And what better way to start than by heading to the Northern Territory? Let's cross now live to Larrakia Country in the Top End for a special performance by the NT Dance Company, choreographed by proud Larrakia man, Gary Lang.
Thank you.
the beautiful work of the NT Dance Company. Today has been filled with passionate and exciting discussions about our future. But before we revisit that, let's reflect on some of what has made headlines over the last year.
The biggest bushfire in Australian history.
The only way out of Cobargo is on fire.
Hundreds dead, thousands infected.
Borders are about to close.
Stay at home.
Hundreds of businesses will close.
1 million people losing their jobs.
Highest rates of aged care deaths from COVID-19 in the world.
Shelves stripped bare.
We've seen the worst of nature and the best of the Australian spirit.
You know, I don't hold a hose, mate.
And now to recap today, never fear, these are the headlines, the gold, it's the short take form. A highlights reel that's been deftly packed and produced into 3 hot minutes. We've had discussion about the economy, about what kind of country we should be, about gender equity, about making our society more equitable generally. We've also had our first ever policy voting online, and it worked. We'll take a look at the day's action right now.
So the starting point for all of us at this conference must be the knowledge and belief that Labor most assuredly can win the next election. Delegates, it can be done. And it's now my pleasure and privilege to introduce the leader who will take us to this victory. Albo loves this party, but his greatest love is of our country. Like so many of us, he's driven by that powerful Australian aspiration to hand on a better deal to the next generation.
I get that, but it's not me. I did pick a side. Yours.
We work to shape an Australia where we can all succeed, where no one is held back and no one is left behind.
In the last 8 years, we have seen the biggest deindustrialisation in Australia's history. And that is the true legacy of the policy indolence of the Morrison Liberal government.
Labor isn't just a party, it's a movement, an organisation of shared meaning, common purpose and solidarity that exists to provide justice for working people. At this conference, let's create a platform that can achieve these things. Let's maintain the momentum that will take Anthony Albanese to the lodge so he can turn that platform into reality. Only a Labor government can be trusted to make Australia into a better place, because only a Labor government ever has.
We are definitely at our wits' end. The government doesn't care about me, doesn't care about the elderly, and it doesn't give a shit about aged care.
Of course, there is no more important challenge right now than the successful rollout of the COVID-19 vaccine. But Scott Morrison is already hopelessly behind schedule, falling almost 3.5 million doses short of his promise to vaccinate 4 million Australians before the end of March, tomorrow.
Our opponents are obsessed with one thing, themselves. But Anthony Albanese and the movement behind him want to build a better Australia. An Australia where early education and childcare is seen as an essential service, not a welfare measure. An Australia where every parent, especially women, can work the hours they want and need. An Australia where every child receives a world-class early education.
So let's win the next election and give Australians a government that's on their side. A government that believes in their capacity to build a stronger, more secure nation.
It's been jam-packed, even in this virtual reality that we are living in. Next up, a performer who last year went from being a junior doctor at Sydney's Prince of Wales Hospital to taking a huge leap to prioritising her music and now has an exciting new album to show for it. A guitarist, a singer, an ARIA chart topper, we welcome warmly Gordy.
My irrationality is like a nationality. I'd rather bear this flag I know. Of my sensitivities, yes, some have taken liberties, but they are everything I know. Challenge all your empathy that's moving at a glacial speed. I'm running on persistence. Give it just a little time. There's always the familiar line, so you have my resistance. And I will not illuminate your words. I will persevere until it hurts. So I can understand how you all came about. And I will not illuminate your words. And I will persevere until it hurts. Give myself up all just to be heard. I will not presume to hate the world.
Thank you so much, Gordy. It was so wonderful you could join us. And speaking of joining us, I have a real life person next to me which calls for a Corona Mup. Will you lay one on me, please?
Very good, Sam.
We welcome now Richard Miles, Deputy Leader of the Labor Party, and I've learned today, not just a Geelong Footy Club supporter, but a real true one.
Fanatic.
You're bona fide.
Indeed.
So, shall we kind of take that dialogue? Because you've been here all day. I could be the journo asking a coach, which I'm kind of more used to in terms of my professional life. What were your key takeouts today, Richard, from the match? Conference.
But, yeah, but before we get there, Sam, as a sports journalist, the Cats this year.
You want a debrief?
Are we going the whole way?
Do you want the analysis?
I do want the analysis.
They've got to deliver, don't they? I mean, grand final last year, third 3 years in the last 5 years.
But we've got
delivery
Cameron.
Day. You've got Cameron, but he's got to get fit.
Why does it take 3 weeks to get over a hamstring?
I don't think this is about the conference. Who was your best? let's key takeouts from the conference, please.
Look, it's been, the conference has come at a really extraordinary moment in our country's history with the end of COVID. And, you know, we've learned a lot during COVID and a lot of good things about our country, people looking after each other, neighbours helping out, the sense of community, the sense that we're really all in this together. But I think COVID has also let us know the way in which the country has drifted. We've lost a lot of factories, of sovereign industrial capability. We've kind of fallen down the technological ladder. And I think what we got today was some answers about how we get out of this. You know, Labor put forward a vision today, Albo put forward a vision, which is about jobs, about climbing the technological ladder. And when you think about, you know, what this mob has done over the last 8 years, they've just let the country drift. You know, today we actually got some answers about the future.
You might have given this answer away in a four-letter name that you've just mentioned, but if you had to give three votes for best on ground today...
I think Albo does get the three votes.
of course, apart from him.
So, I mean, Albo really stood up today and made it clear what we stand for, jobs for the future, what he stands for, about making sure that we can answer the questions of uncertainty that people have. You know, like the kids being able to have a future and a career in this country where they can buy a house. You know, Anthony made it really clear that that's what his leadership's going to be about. That's what an Albanese Labor government would be about. And he also made it clear which side he's chosen, and that's your side.
There are also two votes and one vote in a Brownlow Medal count. So do you want to kind of give some honourable mentions?
Well, I think two votes, and it was a very close call. But Jude Clark, who you saw on that snap just before, who's an aged care worker in WA, who was so compelling today. And I think what we've learnt in the last year is that heroes in this nation have worn a different uniform, perhaps, to the one that we've been used to. It's been frontline workers, carers, people in aged care facilities who, in our home state in Victoria, have, you know, really faced a whole lot of fear around COVID being in a lot of those facilities. These people are looking after, you know, our dearest loved ones. And listening to Jude today and listening to the way in which she feels that the government is not supporting the work that she does is a completely compelling story. And I tell you what, in Jude Clark, you have a reason why people need to be voting Labor at the next election.
Well, on that, you now, and I've taken this footy analogy probably way too far, but look down that barrel. You've got your supporters there, your fans. What do you want to say to them?
Well, to continue the theme, we mean to win. And I mean, we really do mean to win the next election. We're in a great position to do that. But it's so important that we win the next election for the future of the country, to take this moment, which is about reimagining Australia's future coming out of COVID, perhaps a more significant moment to do that than at any time since the end of the Second World War. And our kids' future and our grandkids' future is all about the next election. So if you want to give us your time, we can use that. If you want to join the party, I mean, this conference is the voice of a community of tens of thousands of Australians. Every person joining the Labor Party makes us stronger. Or even if you want to donate, all of that can be done by visiting alp.org.au. We really need you to get involved.
And that website, www.alp.org/onyourside, to join the campaign. And according to Richard, just there. It's never been more important. Thank you so much for that. We've had a bit of fun with the footy, but it's been good talking to you off camera well about the Cats, and good luck to them. Thank you for joining us in real life, like humans. An example of the kind of people Richard was talking about fighting for is someone he also name-checked, a remarkable and passionate aged care worker from WA named Jude.
My name's Jude and I'm an aged carer. I've been in the industry for 48 years. I love what I do. I love my residents and they love me. We give our heart and soul to what we do. Otherwise, we wouldn't be doing what we do. Every time the budget comes out and the funding gets dropped from aged care, they take a big chunk away from us. And I know that I'm going to lose money, hours. We are one person to so many. The numbers vary for anywhere from, 20 to 60, especially on a night shift. Carers are giving their heart and their soul. And it's the government that keep taking the funding away all the time. And they need to damn well fix it and fix it in a hurry. We are definitely underfunded. We are definitely at our wits' end. The government doesn't care about me, doesn't care about the elderly, and it doesn't give a shit about aged care. We just need to be respected. We need to be able to raise our heads and say, I'm an aged care worker and I'm proud of what I do. I'm proud every day that I get to work with these people that are vulnerable, with more funding, with better funding, and with more people coming into the industry and staying in the industry. That can be fixed like that. And it's not happening. We are a very, very special bunch. And we deserve the respect and the pay from the federal government that we need to do our job.
Wow. I was excited about Richard Miles. I don't think he will mind me saying that I am very, very excited that we can welcome, and there are real live rounds of applause here, so bring it on, please. We have Jude Clark here with us in Sydney at the Reesby Workers Club. Jude, you were telling me before we kind of came together that you might just need to hold on to the sideboard because you were nervous.
I am.
I'm watching this with tears in my eyes. Welcome. You've come from WA to join us tonight.
Yeah.
How are you going?
It was great, and having the opportunity to do this is such an honour, to represent people who aren't really thought of very often until you need them.
You are thought of. Your passion actually is just like exuding from you. I can feel it, even though we're being COVID safe and distanced. Mm-hmm. Tell us what it was like making that video that I think we've seen several times today, and it's not like it's losing any impact. Every time I see it, I get goosebumps. What was it like to make?
It was absolutely amazing. The lady who I was with was just such an amazing lady, and she was making me laugh when the camera wasn't on us, and when the camera was on us, trying to stop me from getting too teary and too emotional. But what we're trying to achieve is to bring the emotion, because that we deal with that every day. We deal with the emotion of what we do and how frustrating it is that we can't do what we want to do.
Yep. You reference in the piece, in general terms, your patients generally. Can you share something specifically about one of your very special relationships that you have with a patient?
Yeah, I can. I have so much in my head of the people that have passed, but I remember a couple who came in and we were told that they had to be separated. They were in the same unit, but they had to be separated. They were man and wife for 76 years. And I got my dander up and I got the girls involved, the other girls that I work with. And we demanded that they be put together. So they were in two rooms. So one room became a sitting room and the other room became their room, their bedroom. And we kept them together until the husband passed. And it was only a few days later that the wife passed. So in the end of your life, when you've spent 76 years together and you work go into a nursing home and they say, no, we can't put you together. We're not allowed, you know, we don't have the facility to do that. Find a facility. For goodness sake, give us more funding so we can build facilities for couples. It's not fair to separate someone who's been together for 76 years. It's longer than a lot of people get to live. So we really need this to happen. It's very emotional and it's very difficult what we do. But I don't know anyone I've ever worked with over the 48 years I've been doing this job that don't have the same passion that I have. They might not be as boisterous and as I am, but they all have that passion. Otherwise, we wouldn't do what we do. We certainly don't do it for the money. We don't do it for the notoriety, but we do it because we love what we do.
Again, it's in every sentence you speak, it's in the way that you speak it. Thank you. You express it so vividly also on the video, Jude, but tell us directly how decisions that are made in Canberra stand to affect you and your patients.
Every year that the budget comes out, we see we're going to get so much money for our funding, and then it gets taken off us. And that means hours lost. We lose time with our residents. The unions have done a big survey, and the survey was, if you could fix one thing in aged care, what would it be? It wasn't about the money that we get, which is quite poor. It was about having the time to spend with our residents, to give them the love, to stop the loneliness, and to give them the best ending that they could want. Without that funding, that is not going to happen. And we really need for that to be in everybody's minds when they're going to the polls. For goodness sake, think about who you're putting in power and what they're going to do for you. I know exactly where I'll be voting.
Thank you for telling it like it is for you and for the people you care for so much, Jude. It's been really moving to meet you in person. I could speak to you all night. Your passion's inspiring.
Thank you.
If this pandemic's done nothing else, it's shown us all how important it is that we look after those who care for others, who care for our parents, our grandparents, our loved ones, and the community in general. Jude, you do that.
Thank you.
And now, if you don't mind me handballing something important, it's over to you to introduce our next very special guest.
It's my great honour to introduce a message from Julia Gillard. I don't know if I'm going to get down here without falling over.
A big hello from me to all of the delegates and other Labor supporters gathered for this virtual national conference. Of course, this is a national conference like no other, but it's a national conference with an incredibly important mission. We need over the next few days to chart our nation's course as we come out of the COVID-19 pandemic with a will to build back better, to build a nation that is stronger and fairer for the future. What you decide in coming days will have a huge impact. To take just one example of the way national conferences changed our party and changed our nation, I invite you to reflect on the adoption of the affirmative action rule in the early 1990s. Because delegates at a national conference were prepared to support that rule, we as a political party have been immeasurably strengthened and we have sent more women to Parliament, changing our nation. Of course, so much more needs to be done on gender equality, but it is at national conference that we can take the big strides forward. Over the next few days, your work will be all about gathering Labor's strength as we run towards the next election. So get to it. There is so much to be done. This will be an exciting period, a transformative period, and one I hope we remember as the time in which we set the clear strategy for an election victory.
Thank you, Julia Gillard. It's always wonderful to hear from you, a former Australian Prime Minister and still our first woman Australian Prime Minister. The pandemic has dominated our lives over the last 12 months. It's important that we don't forget that just months before COVID hit, we also suffered our worst bushfires in history. Many of the victims are still today struggling to rebuild their lives and homes. Here's an insight.
I'm Veronica. I've lived in the village of Cuorma for nearly 27 years. Very much part of this close-knit community for all of those years. 2 days after Christmas, my partner and I decided to travel to northern New South Wales. Whilst we were away, the fire moved in on us. We learned in the very early hours of New Year's Eve that the house had been taken. When I came back to this area, I think 10 days after the fire, I went straight to the local community hall. Everything that came into that centre came from local people. It was a long time before we had anybody from any government come anywhere near us. I did hear that Scott Morrison and his entourage visited Cobargo, and I saw what a debacle that was. He couldn't engage. He doesn't have the ability to engage. He didn't want to know. He just walked away. He walked away because he knew he'd let us down. He must have known he'd let us down. 15 months since that fire came and changed our lives forever. Dozens and dozens and dozens of people that I personally know are still living in temporary accommodation. I've got a bus. I consider myself pretty lucky. It's relatively dry. And we're just getting on with it because we've got no choice. But hey, this is a first world country. This is a catastrophic disaster of global proportions. And then you realise our government's not helping us.
Stories like these naturally resonated across the globe. And that's where we find our next guest this evening, who's joining us from the other side of the world. A warm welcome from the Revesby Workers Club to UK Labour leader Sir Keir Starmer.
It gives me great pleasure to send this message to the Australian Labour Party. The relationship between our two parties is one of the strongest bilateral relationships that we have. We have shared history and we have shared values and a shared desire to learn from each other. Both of our parties have suffered very difficult election defeats in recent times. The Liberals in Australia and the Conservatives in the UK resuming government, continuing with the policies that are ripping our two communities apart. We know our parties must rebuild, must engage with our electorates and set out a clear path to government. Because it's only in power that we can make a real difference to people's lives. The priorities that your leader, Anthony Albanese, has set out this week are a great example of why we must win. They're an exciting glimpse of a prosperous future for Australia. And as we emerge from this crisis, we must harness the spirit that got our countries through the darkest of days. Ensure that we don't go back to the way things were. End the deep inequalities within our societies. We can only do that by offering a bold, ambitious, and credible alternative. Let me end by saying that you have a great leader in Anthony. I know he is deeply aware of the problems Australians face, and he has a plan to solve them. So over the coming months and years, I look forward to working with him and look forward to our two great parties continuing to work together. Labour in Britain, Labour in Australia. Together, leading the way, offering a future of hope, peace, and prosperity for our communities, for our countries, and for the world.
Excellent to have the UK Labor leader with us. A reminder as we head into the home stretch of a very big day. If you'd like to send a message or get involved in proceedings, please do. We've been scrolling, we've been seeing it. You might post pictures or video of your local community, of friends and family, and express what matters to you. Or you might just put a post up of you in your tracky dacks watching this conference, because I've seen a few of those too. You are very much encouraged to get involved, to connect and engage and have your voice heard. You might also want to register as a supporter of the Labor Party, be a Labor Party member, and there are many ways to do it. The Australian Labor Party is on Twitter, at Australian Labor. Feel free to tag hashtag ALPConf21. That's where I've spotted the tracky dacks. On Instagram, at Australian Labor. And the Labor Party's Facebook page title is Australian Labor. The website address is alp.org.au. Now, we welcome another former Australian Prime Minister, Kevin Rudd.
G'day. I'm still Kevin, I'm still from Queensland, and I'm still here to help. But these days I'm anxious, deeply anxious about our country's future. That's unusual for me because by nature I'm an optimist. But on the big challenges, Morrison isn't within a bull's roar of having what Australia needs. We need a government that can set Australia up for the future, not just spin their way through the political issues of the day. Albo and his team have not only the political opportunity, but now the national responsibility to take Labor to victory. We together can rebuild manufacturing and unlock new drivers of economic growth and new technology. We don't have to become a country of extreme inequality, like America, feeding political extremism and making the country ungovernable. We can carve out a renewable energy future with new jobs and new businesses. Every other developed country in the world's doing that, but the Conservatives just bury their heads in the sand. We face an uncertain future where the balance of geopolitical power is shifting. It's complex, but it is navigable. We need deep thought, not a Conservative government sleepwalking into a future conflict they've done nothing to help prevent. And sadly, we face future pandemics. Where would we be today without the public health system built by Labor over successive generations, federal and state? It's time to renew that infrastructure with a government that leads, not just shifts the blame onto others. Australians expect their leaders to understand these problems and to be on their side, not acting on behalf of somebody else. They want to know who's on their side on wages and conditions, on affordable housing and childcare, who's on their side on superannuation and a decent retirement income for all, in building the renewable jobs and businesses of the future, and who's on the people's side in preparing for an uncertain century in our own region between the US and China. The bottom line is that Australians can spot a fraud at 50 paces, and that's what they see with Morrison and his mob: frauds, phonies, and marketing men. And they pretty much are all men, and all in it for themselves. Morrison wasn't on their side during the bushfires. Morrison wasn't on their side when he was bullying state premiers to open their borders when it just wasn't safe to do so. And he isn't on their side in taking on the growing problem of corruption which has unfolded on his watch. I've known Albo for nearly 25 years. I'm proud to be his friend. Albo tells it straight, and he keeps his word. He is instinctively on the Australian people's side. You see, we're all a product of where we've grown up. Albo, like me, was raised under difficult circumstances, by and large, by a single mum. It was tough. Albo never forgets where he came from. He's not a slick marketing product invented by spin doctors. Albo is the genuine article. Friends, Australia is at a national crossroads. We face enormous challenges to secure our future. And that requires a leader who Australians know is on their side as we navigate our way through the giant challenges now staring us in the face. I thank you.
Thank you, Kevin. I have it on good authority, excellent authority, in fact, that it is not a proper Labor Party evening function if we don't have at least one song from this legend. I don't need to mention his name because not only do you know his voice, you know his iconic face. Let's see it.
Hey guys, Jimmy Barnes here. I don't usually do requests, you know, by the way, but Tony Burke is my number one fan, and he wanted me to do my new single for you, Flesh and Blood. So how could I say no? This is a song about families and how families, you know, fight like crazy and still manage to get through it and help each other through the hard times. I've got no idea why he would think this song applied to you guys, but maybe you can work that out. Anyway, this is a song I played the other night from my dear departed brother, Michael Gudinski. Daniel Andrews made his memorial service possible, and I want to thank him for that. So here's a song for everyone like Michael, Dan and Tony, because Australian music is part of their flesh and blood. All the best, guys.
Fresh.
The legend that is Jimmy Barnes. Did I say legend? Because there's one on stage here. They're my words. Welcome, please, Penny Wong. May I?
Absolutely.
I'll leave you to it.
Thank you very much, Sam. Australians are tired of political management, tired of politicians who think if they enrol in an empathy course, they'll be able to tell people what they want to hear. Tired of politicians always announcing something, but never actually delivering anything and never taking responsibility. Tired of politicians who are only in it for themselves. Australians are tired of political management and crying out for leadership, because Australians know that real leaders aren't in it for themselves. Australians know that real leaders are on their side. Anthony is the real thing. He's a natural leader. He doesn't need to be taught empathy. He feels it. All his life, he's wanted to help people, to do what he can so people get the chance they deserve. He knows what it means to make the most of what you've got. He's lived it. He's done it tough. He knows what it's like. And he will never forget it. Anthony hasn't just heard lately what people go through. It's not news to him. It's why he's always been on the side of everyday Australians, why he's always fought for working families. He knows the difference it makes. The difference it makes for working families when they have a government that's on their side. And he knows Australians deserve nothing less. I know what it's like to have Anthony on my side. He backed me when others didn't, and I wouldn't be where I am today if it weren't for him. Supporting women is not something he had to seek guidance on. There's no need for soul searching or public confessionals. It's who he is, and it's what he does. And it's not just me who has been able to count on Albo. So many of the Labor women who have been making a mark in public life can say the same. He seeks out our advice. We are not an afterthought. Anthony knows for Australia to be as good as it can be, we need each Australian to be as good as we can be, with a government that's opening doors, not closing them, enabling, listening when people tell him what's holding them back, not just letting people fall behind. I support Anthony because I know Anthony. I've known him for decades. I know his character. He is a brilliant mind, a giant heart, and a down-to-earth soul. A man who respects hard work because he knows what it is to struggle and to work for everything he has. He has that vision and character Australians know of great Labor Prime Ministers, and he will be our next one. So would you please welcome the next Prime Minister of Australia, Anthony Albanese.
Well, thanks very much, Penny. 130 years ago, trade unionists had the vision to take their struggle for decent working conditions from the shearing sheds and the factory floor to the floor of our parliaments. For 13 decades, Labor's historic mission has been to fight for fairness, to imagine a better future for Australia, and then set about creating it. Through good and bad times, it has been Labor governments that have advanced reforms in the interests of working people, in partnership with the industrial wing of our great movement. This special conference is a chance for us to demonstrate our unity of purpose once more. It comes at a moment of reckoning for our country. Over the last 2 weeks, what we used to call once-in-a-century floods have drowned much of our east coast. They come in the wake of an unprecedented fire season that scorched so much of our continent. And in the nation's capital and beyond, women are making a brave stand against a toxic culture that has held them back and endangered them for so long. What these challenges have in common is a government that's in denial about how quickly our world is changing, in denial about the science of climate change, in denial about women's truth. But this government's failings haven't just materialised in the past couple of months. We should never forget that under them, we entered the pandemic from a position of economic weakness, slow growth, flat wages, declining productivity, business investment going backwards, debt which had already doubled, a government that is a reflection of Scott Morrison's character, a man of short-term politics, not long-term vision, an angry man who has mastered the rare art of clenching a glass jaw, a man who doesn't hold a hose, won't hold an inquiry, and never, ever accepts responsibility. A man with an ear of tin, a heart of stone, and a wall of concrete shielding him from the concerns of his fellow Australians. We got an insight into his character when he used the pandemic as a smokescreen to try and ram through legislation that would have struck at the heart of the rights and conditions of working Australians. Chief amongst them would have been the heroes of the pandemic. We heard from one just before with Judy. Nurses, cleaners, aged care workers, childcare workers, shop assistants, truckies, public servants and emergency service workers. In short, the very people who kept the nation moving. He sought not to reward them, but to punish them. And the punishment doesn't end there. On Sunday, he ripped away JobKeeper, the only support that was keeping the economic roof from crashing down on so many small business owners and their employees. Meanwhile, the government has stood back as large profitable companies milked JobKeeper to pay dividends to their shareholders and huge bonuses to their executives. We're talking in the realm of $10 billion here. Compare that to RoboDebt and the malice with which they monstered pensioners and Centrelink clients. That is the Liberals in a nutshell. Strong against the weak, but weak against the strong. Then there are the promises they never kept. They said there would be 4 million vaccinations by the end of tomorrow. But they're currently 3.4 million short. And now we're seeing the consequences of this failure to deliver on their promise playing out in real time. They said that JobMaker would assist 450,000 Australians into work. As of last week, guess how many it's delivered? 609, not 450,000. They have given Australia $1 trillion in debt, but little to show for it in terms of legacy. Not a single major economic or social reform, not a single major new infrastructure project, nothing on improving our schools, our TAFEs, or our hospitals. Nothing to close the gap between First Nations people and non-Indigenous Australia. Nothing to make our economy and society more resilient, able to withstand the next national emergency. During this period, though, they've managed to splurge $1 billion of taxpayers' money on self-promotion and advertising. Scott Morrison leads a government that is out of ideas, it's out of touch, and at the next election, they should be out of office. A government of smirk and mirrors that is not worthy of re-election. But I and Australian Labor take nothing for granted. Tonight I want to talk to you about the values that I would bring to the Prime Ministership, shaped by where I have come from and the vision that Labor offers you and your family. I proudly came from council housing. My values and my politics came from my single mum, who battled hard to bring me up on an invalid pension. I understand what it is to overcome adversity because mum led by example every day as I was growing up. Without her, I'd be nothing. Like the women stepping forward to seek justice, she was a fighter for others. And she'd agree with me that a world in which women have equality will produce a better world for men too. She was a happy woman, even though she had bad health and little in the way of money. She knew the fulfilment that comes from helping others who had even less than she had. She taught me to help people and to serve the community. It's how she lived her life. I saw how much good that government policies and programs did to make our lives better. Medicare, public housing, the invalid pension. Change in society happens when we work cooperatively with others to get things done. And that's why I've always tried to be a builder. I always ask, how can I make positive change happen? And that's why the posts I've held in government have been about doing things, real things. Infrastructure, transport, communications, regional development, local government. Building roads and rail lines, fibre NBN, improving our airports, creating public facilities right across the country. Things get done when you bring people together. And that's what I want to do. I want to work with unions and the business community. Without successful businesses, you don't create jobs. A Labor government will always prioritise the creation of good, secure jobs. And that comes through mutual respect and working towards our common interests. That is why I refused to play politics and was constructive when the pandemic was at its height. I know there's some people who were critical of this, but that's just who I am. What Labor, under my leadership, offers is sound, considered, honest government. A government that faces up to reality, that listens to what people are saying, that accepts expert advice, that has genuine empathy for people's concerns, one that backs the aspirations, which all Australian families have, for a better life, not just for themselves, but for their kids, grandkids, for their neighbours, for their community, and for the country. One that restores confidence in government with a real National Integrity Commission. A government that recognises that out of this once-in-a-century crisis, we have a once-in-a-century chance to rebuild and renew our country, to build back stronger. Here's what I pledge on behalf of Labor. Labor will give working Australians a better deal, not just any job, but a secure job. Job security, better pay, a fairer system. We'll put job security explicitly into the Fair Work Act. We'll give rights to gig economy workers through the Fair Work Commission. We'll consult on portable entitlements for workers in insecure industries. We'll make sure that casual work is properly defined in law. We'll crack down on cowboy labour hire firms to guarantee a pretty simple principle, same job, same pay. We'll put a cap on back-to-back short-term contracts for the same role. We'll promote and ensure more secure public sector jobs. And government contracts will be given to companies and organisations that offer secure work for their employees. We'll expose and close the gender pay gap. It's more than 13%. And give women fleeing family violence 10 days paid leave. Labor will ensure the women and men who work in our care industries, mental health, the NDIS and aged care, get the rights, respect and working conditions they deserve to do their vital jobs. Labor will make childcare cheaper for 97% of families in the system, removing the financial barriers that discourage women from working more hours and pursuing their careers. The next step towards our goal of affordable universal childcare. Labor will deliver a future made in Australia, a future where we make things and stand on our own two feet. We will use the purchasing power of government to buy Australian products and services, supporting Australian jobs and skills. We'll create a national rail manufacturing plan to build more trains here. We will maximise local content in the $270 billion investment pipeline of defence projects. And today, I proudly announced that a Labor government will establish the National Reconstruction Fund. Working in partnership with the private sector, including the superannuation industry, the fund will revive our ability to make world-class products. It will commercialise innovation and technology. It will diversify our industrial base and develop our sovereign capability. And in the process, it will drive regional economic development and create secure, well-paid jobs. We will play to our national strengths and back industries of strategic importance: mining and resources, agriculture, forestry and fishing, medical science, renewables and low emission technologies, defence industries, transportation. This represents nothing less than the largest transformational support for manufacturing in our history. Labor will proudly invest in Australia and in Australian workers. And to power this manufacturing revolution, Labor will rebuild and modernise our energy grid using Australian expertise, Australian steel and Australian workers to deliver cheap, reliable and clean energy. Good for industry, good for households, good for our environment. We will take advantage of our abundant reserves of lithium, nickel, copper and other rare earths the world needs to make electric vehicles, batteries and low emission technologies. We will take advantage of the extraordinary potential of hydrogen technology. My ambition for Australia is to be a renewable energy superpower, and we are committed to achieving net zero emissions by 2050. Tomorrow I will have more to say about Labor's plan to help families and communities play their part in achieving this critical goal, a plan that will make electric cars more affordable and support the rollout of community batteries nationwide. Labor has also heard the generous statement from Uluru, and we will work to build public support for finally recognising First Nations people in our constitution. We're diminished as a nation while that doesn't occur, and we'll give First Nations people a voice to Parliament. Labor has also heard the women of Australia loudly and clearly. While we must do better on childcare, on workplace rights, on closing the pay gap, on women's safety and on representation within our parliaments, we need a seismic cultural shift. You can't seize a moment if you don't understand it in the first place. And quite frankly, a Prime Minister who keeps Andrew Lamming in his party room but removes Christine Holgate from her public service position just doesn't get it. I want to be a Prime Minister for every Australian. I have asked the Shadow Minister for Women, Tanya Plibersek, and the leaders of our Status of Women Caucus Committee, Sharon Clayton and Annika Wells, to lead the process of further developing our comprehensive women's policy to take to the next election. It will be a policy that delivers on the two most important aims: women's economic security and independence, and safety. These aims are indivisible. Labor has always led on gender equality. I was a delegate to this conference in 1984 when we adopted the affirmative action policy that has made us a stronger party and movement. Friends, the choice we will face at the next election is becoming clearer by the day. A tired government that has been in power for 8 long years, that's unravelling before our eyes, led by a man who is an empathy vacuum and an accountability black hole. Or a Labor government that will be on your side. No community forgotten, no worker left behind. With the right policies and the right leadership, I truly believe our country can make this moment our own. An Australia that's inclusive, an Australia that's strong, an Australia that looks to the future with confidence. And that is what we will deliver. Labor is on your side.
Thank you so much, Anthony. Thanks to everyone who took part in tonight's event. And again, to those who participated in proceedings today. An enormous thanks to everyone who has logged in to watch. That's you. Even if we haven't had the traditional conference experience of catching up with old friends and making new ones, we hope you felt part of the event. We hope you felt energised. Thank you and good night. We'll be back tomorrow morning from Revesby Workers Club with day 2.